Welcome to On This Day. Today's date is February 17th. It is the 58th day of winter, and there are 32 days left until spring, almost a month to go. It is President's Day here in the U.S., officially known as Washington's birthday, even though it isn't even actually on Washington's birthday. President's Day is an American federal holiday that takes place on the third Monday in February. We used to have Washington's birthday, then the following Monday we had Lincoln's birthday. At some point, they decided to have both their birthdays on the same day. Kind of rude. Sort of like what my mom did to me and my brother. We were born 3 days and 5 years apart. Always had to share a birthday. Let's take a look and see what February 17th have given us in the past. 1863, a group of citizens from Geneva founded the International Committee for Relief to the Wounded, which later becomes known as the International Committee of the Red Cross. Up until this point, there was no organized or well-established army nursing system for casualties and no safe and protected institutions to accommodate and treat those who were wounded on the battlefield. The ICRC helped change all of that. 1865, the American Civil War, Columbia, South Carolina is burned as the Confederate forces flee from the advancing Union forces. Now, why would they burn their own city? A lot of people would probably want to know that. Back in those days, armies depended on captured farms and towns for supplies and shelter. As a retreating army, the last thing you want to do is leave behind supplies and shelter. You want to leave a big mess if you can. So, usually the armies and the citizens would flee with as much of the supplies as they could. According to legend, Columbia's First Baptist Church barely missed being torched by Sherman's troops. The soldiers marched upon the church and asked the sexton, he's the dude that works at the church, if he could direct them to the First Baptist Church. The sexton directed the men to the nearby Washington Street Methodist Church. Thus, the historic landmark was saved from destruction by Union soldiers. Sort of a dick move, but hey, the sexton got to keep his job, right? 1867, the first ship passes through the Suez Canal, and for decades to follow, it becomes a place of conflict. For some reason, through the 60s and 70s, there was always a couple years where someone blocked the Israelis or somebody else from going through there. That all kind of mellowed out by, I'd say, the 1980s. But yeah, it was rough. It was a rough patch for that place. 1933, Newsweek magazine was first published. The Newsweek was changed to the Washington Post in 1961 and has been since. 1978, the Irish Republican Army detonates a firebomb at the Le Mans restaurant near Belfast, killing 12 and seriously injuring 30 others, all Protestants. 1996, NASA's Discovery program begins as a near Shoemaker spacecraft lifts off on the first mission ever to orbit and land on an asteroid. 2011, the Arab Spring begins. Libya protests against Gaddafi's regime begin. In Bahrain, security forces launch a deadly pre-dawn raid on protesters in the Pearl Roundabout of Manawa. I may have pronounced that wrong. I'm sorry. The day is locally known as Bloody Thursday. Now, the Arab Spring was an anti-government protest, uprising, and armed rebellion that spread across much of the Islamic world in the early 2010s. It began in response to oppressive regimes and a low standard of living, starting with protests in Tunisia. Now, here's the thing. Social media played a big role in this by getting information of protesters and helping fuel the uprisings. In the end, the governments of Yemen, Tunisia, Egypt, and Libya were overthrown. Iraq and Syria fell into civil war. 2015, 18 people are killed and 78 injured in a stampede at the Mardi Gras parade in Haiti. This occurred after a man participating on top of a carnival float during the Mardi Gras was shocked by high voltage wires. Apparently, he grabbed the wires as he was going by. I mean, I don't know if they teach science in schools there, but this whole event was very shocking. Thanks, I'll be here all week. You know, Haiti has to be the most unlucky country. Earthquakes, hurricanes, 90% of Haiti's children suffer from waterborne diseases and intestinal parasites. AIDS and HIV are still flourishing on this island, and they have had hundreds of years of really bad leadership. They just can't seem to get anyone that doesn't want to be a dictator in that place. And, you know, they always have coups and everything. It's just a nightmare there. Stay out of Haiti. Born on February 17th, 1963 was a big year. Larry the Cable Guy, American comedian and voice actor. To the average person, you probably think he is just a dumb dude that makes people laugh. Trust me, this man is a comedy genius, and I'm not even a fan. I don't like really his act or his style of comedy, but his talent is undeniable. 1963 again, Jensen Huang. I may pronounce that wrong. He's a Taiwanese-American businessman and co-founder of NVIDIA. It's a graphics card company for computers. Chances are you have some of his product in your computer right now. He is also a graduate of the same high school my kids graduated from. 1963 again, Michael Jordan is born. American basketball player and actor. He also played baseball for a while. Probably the most famous basketball player on the planet. He was he's a mediocre baseball player, the man knows his way around a pair of balls. Speaking of balls, 1981, Paris Hilton is born. Died on February 17th, 1909, Geronimo, American tribal leader. Yes, he was real. Geronimo isn't just something you say when you jump off a bridge. He was a prominent leader and medicine man of the Apache people. We actually, in the U.S., have three towns named after him. One in Arizona, one in Oklahoma, and Texas. And during World War II, we named a Liberty ship Geronimo. He died on this day in 1909 on Fort Sill in Oklahoma. If you've ever been stationed at Fort Sill, you'd probably think dying is a good option instead of being stationed there. 2014, Bob Castle, American guitarist, keyboard, and producer. He was most famous for being a member of the new wave band Devo. I've always been a fan of Devo. I've probably seen him 10 times in my life, and most people only think they wrote the one song Whip It. No, they've got, you know, 40 years of music. If you're a fan, you're a fan. If you're not, you probably think they suck. It's weird. It's a very hot and cold relationship with the rest of human beings. You either love Devo or you hate Devo. There's no in between. All right, so that's today's video. Hope you guys enjoyed it. I will see you tomorrow for February 18th.